Children's television weren't always dirty words. The golden age of children's television stretches from the 1940s to the 1970s, but I contend that a shard of that wonder persisted through the ultra-commercial 1980s, if you know where to look for it. So, what went right? Happy Halloween, everyone. So I was sitting around the other day trying to think of a Halloween-themed film or episode of an 80s television show that also had educational merit. That is the thesis of this show, after all. And while I could do Garfield's Halloween Adventure from 1985 because those pirate skeleton ghosts scared the pants off me, it wasn't exactly educational. A friend suggested It's the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown, though that was made in 1966 and falls outside of my time frame. Finally, I settled on Sesame Street, specifically the inadvertent nightmare fuel and scary made safe for all its young viewers. So let's start with two little guys who had me diving for the safety of under the dining room table every single time.
Not Mars.
Nope.
Earth.
Yep.
Huh? Look. Hello.
Greetings. Greetings.
Hello. Hi there.
Those are the Martians, and while there are three of them, usually only two would appear at the same time, and my extensive research discovered that the two most often seen Martians are named Joe and Bob. They descend from the sky like a pair of Elder God air squid, and, armed with their guidebook to Earth, try to greet and understand the various inanimate objects they meet. Maybe it was something about their design, with huge, unhinged mouths they could hide their own heads under, or their unblinking eyes and multitude of tentacles. Maybe it was the creepy space sounds that accompanied them, and the way they could teleport themselves right into sealed buildings. Maybe it was the fact that most of their scenes involved empty houses and rooms, as if they'd just come after a terrible catastrophe that's left the whole world abandoned. Whatever it was, I was absolutely terrified. Carol Wilcox, a workshop supervisor and puppeteer, designed the Martians from chenille hats for episode 0407, which leaves me wondering what people were wearing in 1972 to inspire this kind of design. Incidentally, Carol Wilcox was also responsible for the design of Elmo and was considered the expert Muppet maker until her retirement in 1990. The Martians share one of the highest of the guiding ethos for Sesame Street, child relatability. These aliens find themselves in an unfamiliar setting, much like a child might as they grow, and like a child, they seek to communicate in that new setting. Though they are confused, they still want to understand, and they approach learning about their surroundings with curiosity, not frustration or aggression. Eventually they are able to communicate, or think they have anyway, and are happy, having learned more about this mysterious Earth and its confounding inhabitants. In researching for this episode, I found that a lot of people were absolutely terrified by the Martians, but not really able to articulate why. If something is designed in good faith to please, but inadvertently terrifies, That qualifies it as nightmare fuel. So let's move on to something scary, designed to be friendly and educational.
Mirror. No reflection on you, of course.
Count Von Count was created in 1972 by the legendary Norman Stiles and voiced by Jerry Nelson until his death in 2012. Jerry was also the main puppeteer for the Count until he left to concentrate on The Muppet Show and Fraggle Rock in the mid-80s. Coincidentally, Norman Stiles was the head writer for episode 1839, Farewell, Mr. Hooper, and was one of the producers behind the Emmy-winning show Between the Lions. While the Count is definitely meant as a parody of a vampire, specifically Bela Lugosi's portrayal of Dracula, Sesame Street has gone back and forth on his supernatural origins. In early sketches, he uses hypnosis on other Muppets, turns into a bat, and is shown without a reflection, while later storybooks and guides to the show state that he is absolutely not a vampire. However, the Count suffers from arithmomania, the compulsion to count objects in one's surroundings, said to be a classic trait of vampires in Eastern European myth.
You know that I am called the Count, because I really love to count. Sometimes I sit and count all day, but sometimes I get carried away. I count slowly, 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 getting faster. Once I start in counting, it's very hard to stop. Hey, faster, faster, it is so exciting. I could count forever, count until I drop. One, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, one, two. I love counting, whatever the amount. One, two, three, four, hey, 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 hey.
The idea of the vampire is cross-cultural. Some form of risen dead that preys upon the living exists in virtually every country and can be said to be a universal human fear. Here in Sesame Street, this vampire is a happy, if melodramatic, person who delights in counting and the expression of numbers, even more so if there are others involved to share his joy. Though he lives in a spooky castle with a cloud of bats, those are his dear pets, and the scary thunder and lightning that accompany his counting are courtesy of his own personal thundercloud. The Count is a comic figure with an educational obsession in the guise of a supernatural creature of legend. How could a child not fall in love with that? As with any long-lived Muppet character, he also has quite a bit of background only hinted at during sketches. For example, the Count is of minor nobility, as he mentions he's called the Count because he loves to count, and also because he inherited the title from his father. He's said to always know the exact time, and therefore the exact second of midnight, as well as having previously been the professor of counting from 1 to 10 at the Institute of Technology in Moldavia. The Count is also quite a ladies' man, having been romantically involved with Countess von Backwards, Countess Darling von Darling, a mysterious woman known only as the Countess, and with Lady Two. His brother, mother, and uncle have also appeared in various episodes, and we've seen him as a child counting in the Carpathian Mountains. Finally, any discussion of Sesame Street and scary stuff would be remiss not to mention the fact that all the fuzzy Muppets, that is, any Muppet that is not humanoid, they are all members of the monster race.
Wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute, here they come!
The monsters of Sesame Street, and of the Muppets in general, are all related. They all have the same last name, Monster, and their puppets are created from the AM Monster template. AM stands for Anything Muppet, meaning simple designs that can be adapted for a multitude of styles and characters. There are 35 known variants of the AM Monster template, including Shaggy Blue, Yellow Live Hand, Gray Pearhead, and Orange Ovalhead. Some of the more famous monsters like Grover, Cookie Monster, and Oscar the Grouch are custom builds who predate Sesame Street, but others, most famously Telly Monster and Elmo, came about early in the show's run. I've done a lot of digging, but I'm unable to find any conclusive evidence that the monsters of Sesame Street, and there are over 120 of them, were designed as monsters for any real educational purpose. Early Muppets that Jim Henson created for commercials do appear to be monstrous, and it's very possible he just enjoyed dreaming up these fantastic beasts and bringing them to life. Because they're cute and not scary, they're a fantastic method of audience engagement. They take on human characteristics and flaws, sharing a young child's triumphs and insecurities. In fact, Grover stars in a book first published in 1971 called The Monster at the End of This Book, where he is warned of a monster and tries to convince the reader to stop turning pages, only to find out that he, lovable, furry old Grover, was the titular monster at the end. This was my favorite childhood book, and it's still in print today. Sesame Street could be scary by accident, or take that which is most frightening and render it harmless. Fear is ever present in a child's world, from the shadow on the wall at night to terrible real-world disasters that strike suddenly and seemingly without cause. I'll cover this more thoroughly in a later episode, but Sesame Street did produce an episode after 9/11 to help children deal with the trauma of a disaster and the fear they might still feel. Halloween is a time for scares, but fear is fierce when it stops being fun. And in this, Sesame Street shines. They did it right.